Good afternoon, everybody. We are honored to have Professor Rolf-Dieter Heuer with us delivering the Boğaziçi lecture today. Before we start, I'd like to say a couple of words about our esteemed speaker. Professor Heuer studied physics in Stuttgart and received his PhD in particle physics from the University of Heidelberg in 1977. After that, he worked at a number of institutes and taught at the University of Hamburg. Between 1994 and 1998, he was the spokesperson for the Opal experiment, one of the four large experiments running at the Large Electron-Positron Collider at CERN. This was the accelerator that occupied the tunnel that the Large Hadron Collider is currently occupying at CERN. And before becoming the Director General of CERN, he was the Research Director for the Particle and Astroparticle Physics at DESI, one of the top five accelerator facilities in the whole of the world. And during his tenure there, he guided oriented particle physics groups towards LHC. He encouraged them to join both of the big experiments at CERN, the ATLAS and the CMS experiments. And he was the CERN director. He became the CERN director general in 2009. This was a period, which was a period where the lab was going through a relatively difficult phase. The LHC had just broken shortly after its first running. And so it had just gone online, and then immediately within a week it had broken. So it was a time like that. You might also remember that period was the time of financial crisis in the whole of the world. So there was a pressure on all the budgets. So everybody was behind austerity. During these 2009 and up to last month, essentially, during his tenure as the Director General, he led through a multiple set of different things. One of them, of course, is the famous discovery of the Higgs boson at the Large Hadron Collider. But beyond that, we had other interesting events that happened during his tenure. Some of them are related to diplomatic things. For instance, CERN becoming more of an international, worldwide facility beyond Europe, and decisions about how it's going to expand were taken during his tenure. And from our point of view, from Turkish point of view, this was also the time when Turkey became an associate member. So, it was both interesting for CERN and for our country. Now that his tenure is over, as far as I know, he will be taking a position as the president of the German Physical Society in April this year. This is the largest largest organization of its kind in the world. He is also going to be the president of the SESEMI, Synchrotron Light for Experimental Science and Applications in the Middle East. This is another project that Turkey is also involved in. And he is also a member of the high-level group of scientific advisors of the European Commission Scientific Advice Mechanism. So we are really happy to have him with us today. And I'm sure we'll have an excellent talk. So I invite Professor Heuer.
Thank you very much for this very kind introduction. I'm very pleased to be here. I must say it's several firsts. It's my first visit to Istanbul. Up to now, I only knew the airport. It's my first visit to your university. And it's the first talk after my tenure of Director General. So I have to get adjusted to that because I took January essentially off in order to recover a little bit for my free time, which was just described. So I have changed the talk title a little bit, going more in the role of science for the sustainable development of the society. And in particular, of course, I want to emphasize the role of large scientific infrastructures. And here, of course, I will give the example of CERN from time to time. And in the middle of the talk, I cannot avoid, I have to show you some science. Okay, it's not only politics or diplomacy, there's also some science. Okay, but I start with a key message. I think everybody agrees that we today, and not only today, in the past several years, we have really a challenging period. And I think all regions have to step up in support for research and innovation, because that's the only thing, only way, in order to have a sustainable development of science and technology. And that's necessary for the upturn and the growth of everybody's economy. And when the United Nations have issued their sustainable development goals last year, you can have these goals, but they are not worth anything if you don't have science, research, and the people who support that and who are able to do that, if you don't have these in order to support it. You need that. And it's, I think it's obvious that research infrastructures are important tools to achieve this. So what is the mission of research infrastructures? Well, first of all, research. We want to push forward the frontiers of knowledge. We really would like to go deeply into the microcosm, or into the early universe, or into the outer universe, etc., etc. If you do research at the frontier of knowledge, you need innovation. You need innovative technologies. You have to develop new technologies, cutting-edge technologies. You can't buy anything what you need from the shelves. You have to develop it yourself. But you cannot do these two things without education. You need to train scientists and engineers of tomorrow. And I think everybody, every country needs scientists, every country needs engineers. And you have to do outreach. You have to promote science in society. If society doesn't understand or at least appreciate science, you are lost. So you have to tell society what you are doing, why you are doing it. You have to promote that. So this is the mission of research infrastructures. And of course, there's an excellent example, and that's CERN. CERN was founded in 1954 by 12 European states, and at that time it was science for peace. You have to imagine the discussions for the laboratory like CERN started in 1949. Europe was in ruins in 1949. Many countries were not very much on ease with each other, and then that you had a handful of eminent scientists, of visionary scientists, and a handful of visionary diplomats getting together, having the idea of a laboratory beyond the borders of the individual European countries in order to compete with other regions of the world in science, in basic science. That's the way to get out of the ruins. And it took them 5 years that these visionary scientists and diplomats wrote the convention for CERN, which is, by the way, very nice to read, because it does not fix everything to the comma and point. It really leaves very much interpretation open, which helps us to change our direction from time to time. So it took 5 years, and in 1954, 12 European states signed the convention. Today we have 21 member states, and it was just mentioned that we have made a very big decision in 2010, because we have redefined the E in CERN from Europe to everywhere. So all countries, independent of their geographical location, can become member states of CERN. And as a consequence, since two years, we have Israel as the first member state from outside Europe. In addition, we have associate member states since last year, Pakistan and Turkey. I think you joined in May, if I'm not mistaken, and Pakistan in July. We have two states in accession to membership, that's Romania and Serbia. And you see, we have quite a few states which applied for membership or associate membership. And if you look on some of the names like Russia, Ukraine, India, and then Pakistan, you see it's still the slogan Science for Peace, I think, is still correct, and that's the same with Sesame. Sesame is modeled after CERN in order to bring scientists from different cultures together doing science. So today, as I said, we have 21 member states. We have nearly 4,000 people on our payroll, 2,300 staff and around 1,400 other paid personnel, out of which more than 50% are young people in the first postdoc position. And we have altogether between 12 and 13,000 scientific users using the facilities at CERN for their different experiments. And the budget, and I can proudly say that the budget was stable over the, even over the economic crisis time, which was a bit of an effort, but it was stable. And it's around 1.1 billion Swiss francs per year. And I must say, it's a unique international facility. And why is it international? Well, first of all, it started as a European, and is still a European intergovernmental organization. So we have treaties with the countries. But it's globally used from the very beginning. But one thing one has to keep in mind, it's an infrastructure which belongs to all its member states and its associate members. So this infrastructure now also belongs, with a certain amount of percentage, also to Turkey. So it's your infrastructure, which is so large that you cannot have it at home, so you have it at the border between France and Switzerland. And I think it's a very nice example of what Europe can achieve when Europe is working together. And I think that we should tell the politicians more often. And today, it's really a global collaboration, and I want to show you this on the next slide. Science, at least our science, is getting more and more global. And this is a distribution of all the CERN scientific users by the location of the institute, not by their passport, but by the institute where they are employed. And this is a snapshot of September last year. And you see around 70%, two-thirds or three-quarters are coming from the member states, and one-quarter, one-third is coming from the rest of the world. And you see Turkey with nearly 130 scientists coming to CERN or doing their experiments, you are a large pillar in the whole group of scientists doing work at CERN. And I think people coming to CERN, working at CERN, they don't care where the other person comes from, what culture the other person has, etc. They talk science. It's really diplomacy through science. I like this very, very much. I mean, this is one of the nicest things, I must say, at CERN for me, that people were working so nice or are working so nicely together. So I repeat the key message again, but now I change it a little bit. It's still the same reason, but now I want to point out that research infrastructures are vital for large-scale projects. You cannot do large-scale projects without a functioning, challenging infrastructure with good people who are working there. And what are large-scale science projects? Well, they address fundamental science questions at the forefront of research and at the forefront of technology. And again, I cannot avoid it. I have an excellent example that's called CERN. And what is our scientific challenge? Well, I think everybody wants to understand the very first moments of our universe after the Big Bang. At the moment of the Big Bang, the universe was an extremely small, extremely hot, extremely energetic point somewhere. And then it was expanding over the past roughly 14 billion years to a size of today, roughly 10 to the 28 centimeters, and cooling down to 2.7 Kelvin Celsius would be pretty much global warming. 2.7 Kelvin, so 2.7 above absolute zero. I have it here on one ruler. On the bottom right, you have the universe today, 10 to the 28 centimeters. On the top left, you have the size of the universe at the moment of the Big Bang, 10 to the minus 32 centimeters. Now, for me, it is extremely difficult to imagine. These are numbers which are very, very important in order to describe the evolution of the universe. However, it's very, very difficult to imagine these numbers. Who can imagine 10 to the 28 centimeters? I cannot. Maybe I can help you a little bit. If you replace the centimeters by dollars, you have roughly the square of the American deficit. Doesn't help me very much. Okay, but both numbers are extremely difficult to imagine, but they are extremely important in order to describe the evolution of the universe. So how can I now look into the history of the universe, in the beginning of the universe? I can go into the large scale. At the large scale, I can use either ground-based telescopes or space-based telescopes in order to look into the history of the universe. And the better the resolution of the telescope, the further back I can look. Yeah? So higher resolution, further back in history I can look. I have a problem there. If I do this with light particles, with photons, then I am running against a wall, and this wall is roughly 380,000 years after the Big Bang. In the first 380,000 years, the universe was still so hot that no stable matter could exist. So matter and energy were fighting against each other, so to speak. So any photon which was produced was immediately eaten up again because it had enough energy to ionize the matter particles. However, around 380,000 years, the universe was cool enough so that photons could escape. They didn't have enough energy to ionize the atoms, so stable atoms could exist and the photons could escape, and that these are the photons we are seeing in the microwave background. 380,000 years, which is not so bad to get to 380,000 years close to the Big Bang. However, we would like to get closer. Now, in order to get closer, we can go to the small scale. And at small scale, you are not using telescopes, you are using microscopes. So you use super microscope, and the Large Hadron Collider is nothing else than a super microscope. For the ones who are not so much in science, if you can't read anything, you need glasses, then you take a magnifying glass, then you take a microscope, then you take an electron microscope, and then you have already an accelerator, and then you go to a higher and higher acceleration. And therefore, the higher the energy of your accelerator, the more powerful its resolution. And the LHC is the most powerful microscope and has a resolution of roughly 10 to the minus 16, 10 to the minus 17 centimeters. But here is now really the big difference which one has to appreciate. With the telescopes, you are really looking back into the history. With a microscope, you are reproducing the conditions at that moment. So you are not looking back, you are reproducing the conditions on a microscopic spot in your accelerator. So that's the big difference, and this is why we can come so close to the Big Bang. So what have we learned during that time? Well, we have learned during these times, before the LHC started, of course you all know the atoms consist out of the nuclei and the electron, the nuclei in turn out of protons and neutrons, the protons and neutrons in turn out of the quarks. And now with the LHC, we come closer and closer and can look deeper and deeper into the structure of the subatomic particles. And at the same time, we can look closer and closer to the Big Bang. So with the LHC, we get closest to the Big Bang. We get as close as 10 to the minus 12 seconds. So we are breaking this wall of the hidden universe behind the 380,000 years, whether with photons we cannot go. So let's look into the microscopic world now, which also describes the early universe. Well, that's called our standard model of particle physics. And you see we have so-called quarks and so-called leptons. These are the more heavy particles, these are the light particles. And we have three families of two quarks and two leptons each. Now, the visible world consists only out of three particles. All of you, everybody here, everything here consists only out of these three particles. The up quark and the down quark are making the protons and the neutrons. Two up, one down makes the proton, two down, one up makes the neutron. And the electron is there in order to finalize the atom. These three particles are the only ones we need to describe the visible world. Now, nature has made the second family and the third family, and the difference mainly is that the corresponding particles in the horizontal row are heavier and heavier if you go from left to right. The top quark is the heaviest elementary particle which we know. It is as heavy as a gold atom, however, it is point-like. Again, difficult to imagine, but that's it. Now, between these particles, they have to talk to each other. They have to exchange information, how should I react, how should I act, etc. So these are the forces which bind or disintegrate these particles. The photons are the messengers of the electromagnetic force which you need in order to stabilize the atom. The gluons are the mediators of the strong force which binds the nuclei together, for example. And the Z and the W bosons are responsible for the weak interaction, which is partially are transmitting the weak interaction, which is partially responsible also for the processes in the sun. So this is a very, very easy periodic system of the microcosm. To my mind, it's even easier than chemistry because there are much less particles in. So this describes the microcosm, this describes our knowledge about the visible world. And this standard model has been tested over decades with very high precision. However, before the LHC was turned on, there was this critical question left open: how do elementary particles acquire mass? Now, when I give outreach talks, many people are asking, why should I be interested how these particles get mass? Well, you should be very interested, because if these particles would be massless, you would not exist. Because massless particles fly with the in the universe with the velocity of light, there's essentially no chance to form composite matter. So composite matter can only be formed once you have massive particles, and this is why it's so important to understand why these how these particles got their mass and how this then can create the matter we have around us. So this Higgs particle is very, very important in order to keep the whole thing together in order to make stable matter, and this was the last missing cornerstone in particle in the standard model. Okay, so I think I hopefully convinced you that a large-scale science project addresses science questions at the forefront of research and technology, but it needs large and, that's very important, sustained infrastructures, and it needs global collaboration on long timescales. It's very long timescales. And one of the best examples is a Large Hadron Collider, which is one of the largest scientific instruments ever built, 27 kilometers of circumference. Many more than 10,000 people were involved in design, construction, and now in the exploitation. And it collides protons, the nuclei of the hydrogen atom, to reproduce the conditions at the beginning of the universe, and we do that 40 million times a second. So this is really a fantastically large infrastructure, and you have to keep in mind the first idea, the first paper about such an infrastructure came out in 1983. And this is now more than 30 years ago. So you need sustained support. And this is how it looks like, how a director general wants to see it, because nobody is in there, everything is closed, and we can put the particles in. When we have shutdown, then of course many people were in there and they're working on that. And we had 2 years shutdown in 2013 and 14 in order to bring the machine up to full specification. Now, how do we do that? Well, we accelerate in these blue magnets, these are magnets, cryostats of the magnets. We accelerate two beams of protons, one in clockwise and one anti-clockwise, with some 2,800 packets in each of the beams, and it goes close to the speed of light. In each packet, we have more than 100 billion protons per bunch, and then at the experiments where we want to measure what happens, we collide these bunches. And in the collision of these bunches, several tens of the protons are colliding and break into their fundamental constituents. The rest flies further, and so we can use the beam for many, many hours as long as we want to keep it in. Sometimes we keep it in for 24 hours before we refill it with new particles. So it breaks into the constituents. And these constituents, the quarks or the gluons, they interact at a very high energy density, much, much higher temperature than at the center of the sun. However, in a much more confined space. So it's not the energy, it's the energy density, the energy divided by the area of the proton or of the quark. And then, of course, you have to measure what happens in such collisions. So we built powerful detectors, digital cameras around the collision point and detect these collision products, and then we reconstruct what happened in the collision. So it's pretty easy. However, you need, of course, accelerator technologies which then spin off into societies, into society. Cryogenics. We are running the accelerator at a temperature of 1.9 Kelvin, that's colder than outer space. And that was a development over many years for these magnets. 12,000 amps are flowing through the leads. a vacuum, 10 to the minus 13 atmospheres. It's a better vacuum than on the moon. And the magnets have an 8 Tesla field. So these were all developments which took around 10, 15 years to develop that and then to build it. And this now spins off into the society, for example, into hospitals with superconducting magnets in treatment of patients, etc. Now, 2010, we started a new era in fundamental science when we explored this new energy frontier with this machine here. And we have four experiments, four big experiments at four points where we collide the particles. We have two omnipurpose experiments, CMS and ATLAS, one specific experiment which looks for a specific type it looks essentially into the difference of properties between matter and antimatter particles. And we have a fourth experiment which looks into the collisions which we from time to time deliver of lead-lead ions. Now, just to imagine, that's one of the big experiments, the ATLAS experiment, at the time of construction. Now it's filled with instrumentation. You have more than 100 million sensors of different type here in there. And you see, you can appreciate the size. This is the size of an average technician. So it's roughly 25 meters, 25 meters, 45 meters in length. And your university is a strong partner in this experiment. The second big experiment is the CMS experiment, which is slightly smaller. It is only 15 times 15 times 25 cubic meters. You see here again the person to compare the size. And now I have made a mistake. I forgot the university on that slide. I'm sorry for the CMS members. I know that CMS is also Boğaziçi, correct? Boğaziçi University is also partner in CMS. I apologize for that, okay? I will always remember it from now on, okay? But the point I want now to make here is both CMS as well as ATLAS, they have around 3,000 members from around 40 countries. Can you imagine 3,000 scientists working in one big experiment? Can you imagine that 3,000 scientists, that means at least 300 full professors, which means at least 300 egos? Well, I'm a professor, I can say that easily. That does not mean that the others are not egos, by the way, also, okay. But the fantastic thing is, it works. It works, yeah? Without a clear line of command, without a clear hierarchy, yeah? Because a professor from Boğaziçi University, if you tell somebody from German University to do something specific or vice versa, your colleague would say, come on, do it yourself. I do what I want. But it works here. But why does it work? Well, it's a sociological phenomenon that it works. Because people see that they cannot do it alone it's useless. They are helpless. So it's a place where people can learn to work together. They have to learn it. It's collaboration and competition at the same time. And here is another key message. Science, research, is not only competition. Science needs competition. You need competition, otherwise you don't have good science. But competition does not exclude collaboration. The groups inside the experiment, they compete, and the experiments compete. However, they also collaborate. As soon as they find something specific, something interesting, they collaborate. So it is really co-opetition, so to speak. It's a new word. You learn diversity. You have a good opportunity to recognize differences, to accept them and to learn to use them. With a diverse crowd of people, you can make much better science than if you have just one type of people. I think the whole thing influences the way of thinking and planning at a general level. Important is the information sharing, the role of computing in internationalization and communication. And I think all this experience can be used by individuals and in other fields. Sometimes I'm dreaming that politics would also learn from that, but it's still a dream. But the management itself is done through the common goals, because the spokesperson at the leader of the experiment has no power. Yeah? The power is convincing partners. That's it. It's convincing. It's motivation. And I don't know. Maybe I think it's in our genes that we can do that. I don't know. I mean, it works. So now, if you have such a fantastic experiment, a fantastic machine, great collaborations, what can you do? Well, the study of the data will allow us to address, I'm not saying to answer, will address some of the key questions. What was the primordial state of matter at the Big Bang before the protons and before the neutrons were formed? We still don't understand that. Have we found this famous Higgs particle? Will we find the reason why antimatter and matter did not completely destroy each other? It's also a question why we are here. Because normally matter and antimatter are produced in the same quantities and they are annihilating when they meet each other. So there is a very tiny difference in the properties of matter and antimatter. And this is why we can exist. Still, we don't understand everything. And the small question, will we find the particle or particles that make up the mysterious dark matter in our universe? And what's dark energy? After all, the standard model, which we have now more or less finalized, describes just 5% of the universe, the visible universe. 95% are this dark universe, dark matter and dark energy. This tiny question is fun. It's interesting. I hope I live long enough that we get at least some glimpse into that. Now, let's go to the Higgs. Have we found it? The answer is yes, you know. We made the discovery in 2012. The Nobel Prize in Physics was given to two of the three main inventors. The third one was unfortunately passing away a few years before. In 2013, it was awarded jointly to François Englert and Peter Higgs. And I like this quote here very much because it describes everything in one single sentence. Yeah? For the discovery of the mechanism, etc., confirmed through the discovery of the fundamental particle by ATLAS and CMS at CERN's Large Hadron Collider. So very nice quote. And I can say it took 48 years to discover that particle which these people predicted. And that was only possible through a global effort at a unique large-scale facility and after the development of new technologies. It took the 48 years because we didn't have the technologies before. And you see there how much sustainability you need in order to do this. And maybe one nice side effect, these two gentlemen here, 48, now more than 50 years ago, they wrote their papers independently. And the first time they physically met was at the seminar at CERN 2012. I could not imagine that happens in particle physics. But it tells you something about the character of these people. Very nice people, by the way, but not very visible. Now, this particle is very, very special. This is a fantastic particle which we have here. Because all matter particles have a certain spin. They have in our nomenclature, they have the spin 1/2. And all the force particles also have spin. They have spin 1. And the Higgs particles, they are the only particles which have spin 0. They have no spin. They are scalar. So the Higgs is neither matter, then it would have spin 1/2, nor force, then it would have spin 1. The Higgs is really different. It is the first and up to now only fundamental scalar which we have discovered. So we have for the first time a third type of fundamental particles in our hands, well, for 10 to the minus 22 seconds or so, but okay. But we can study its behavior. And it represents a scalar field everywhere in the universe because it gives mass to the particles everywhere in the universe. And this dark energy is also a scalar everywhere in the universe. So it must be also a scalar. So we have here two scalars. I'm not saying that Higgs is responsible for the dark energy, but both are scalars. So if we investigate one of the only scalar which we have in our hands, maybe we find something out about the behavior of scalars in general. So this is an interesting way maybe in order to get a first glimpse of dark energy. So the Higgs, I'm very often asked, now you have discovered it. That's over, huh? Nothing else to do. Well, it's only the beginning. So what's next? Well, the question is it the Higgs boson or is it one of many? You know, when you have a family with a single child, the single child usually behaves differently as if you have a family with many children. But sometimes the differences are very small. And here it could also be that the difference is very, very small and that we have only one of the many children. So we have to measure with high precision the properties of this discovered Higgs boson. Its properties could give information on the dark matter and maybe could give first indications on dark energy. And just to remind you, just 5% of the visible universe are described by the standard model with the Higgs particle. Roughly 3/4 are dark energy, which drives the universe apart, and 1/4 is dark matter, which we know from astrophysical observations. And I think our understanding, or at least my understanding of the universe, is changing in the next years. So what is dark matter? This intriguing question. Dark matter can be seen from in collisions of galaxies. It can be seen from deviation of light. It can be seen by the rotation of galaxies, etc. So this is now a more and more precise result about dark matter. So we know very well how much dark matter is in the universe. But what could it be? Well, it could be particles of supersymmetry. And this supersymmetry is an additional possible symmetry of space-time. Here you have the standard model particles. You have them, I had them in a different way, but these are the ones from my first transparency on the standard model. And each of these standard model particles gets a supersymmetric particle, which is a sort of hidden world. So you double the number of particles, and hopefully you'll get a much better understanding of the world around us. But the key here is that the Higgs boson could interact also with the supersymmetric particles. Now, if it interacts with these supersymmetric particles, this would change its properties. The stronger this interaction is with the SUSY particles, the more deviation in the property you would find. The less strong it is, the smaller the deviation. So we have to measure more and more, and we have to measure all properties of the Higgs boson very precisely. And just to remind you, the Large Hadron Collider is the only Higgs factory, the only top ZW, whatever particle factory on the planet, for many years to come. So we have to use this for many, many years. This is why we have a roadmap for the LHC. And you see, the roadmap goes to beyond 2035. We are now here in 2016, so we have a program of green, this is running time, and red, this is shutdown time to improve the accelerator. We have a program of more than 20 years where we want to run the accelerator. And very important, in the middle of this running, we have the upgrade of the LHC to higher luminosity. Why do you need an upgrade? Now, when you are running for 10 years with roughly the same collision rate per year, then it's obvious you need another 10 years in order to double the statistics. That's boring. That's very boring and very inefficient. So you have to upgrade. So we will upgrade here so that from then on we can have 5 times higher collision rate per year accumulated. So instead of 10 years doubling rate, we have 2 years doubling rate. And then it becomes interesting again. Okay, so that is at the moment our idea about running the machine for 20 years. I told you at the beginning, 1983, the first paper on the LHC. If you run for more than 20 years, 2035 plus 20 makes more than 50 years. It's a lifetime of an average physicist. Okay, but it's an interesting lifetime. Okay, so it's obvious, in order to address these questions, you need large and sustained infrastructures. And it's obvious you need global collaboration on long timescales. This is, by the way, a real challenge, especially for universities, to keep the ball rolling here. However, in turn, these large-scale science projects provide a unique equipment. They have challenging requests for high technology, for innovation. There is a lot, they create a lot of stimulating ideas which attract good people. And again, bringing the world together, it's an occasion to bring people together. So, back to research in general. It generates knowledge, it generates an innovation, and it can generate disruptive innovation and thereby changing society. And I think that's one of the key issues of basic science, basic research, that some of the results you have no idea where it can lead to. This is disruptive innovation. So it's not planned, it's really disruptive. And one of the best examples from CERN is the World Wide Web, World Wide Web, 1989. It has changed the world. It was just a side product from our work. Today, 10, 12, 13 years ago, we started the worldwide LHC computing grid, a little bit different to the World Wide Web. It's today the cloud computing, so that was more or less a starting point of the cloud computing, or one of the driving forces, one of them, in the cloud computing. So we are connected with we have two very large data centers, one at CERN and one in Hungary. Then we are connected with 13 large data centers around the world, which in turn are connected to more than 100 sites to store and analyze the data, nearly 160 sites, more than 2 million jobs per day, tremendous amount of storage. It's maybe the largest international collaboration at the LHC. It's larger than the individual experiments. And the point I want to make here with these examples on the science and on the application is the virtuous circle. You have basic research creates innovation. Innovation is used for applied research. Applied research again brings innovation, goes back to basic research, stimulates basic research. That's a virtuous circle. And there is a synergy between research and innovation, which results not only in societal and economic impact, but very importantly in the creation of enhanced opportunities for further developments. So this is really a circle which is absolutely vital for research. It needs to remain strong. You cannot just stop applied research or stop fundamental research. You have to support both of them. So this circle needs to be unbroken and to be supported over long term. That's the only way to make progress in research. And this innovation and fundamental research stimulates innovation, as I said. So space, for example, the Apollo missions. I think at that time, many young people decided to study engineering because they wanted to be part of that of these projects. Particle physics, now with LEP, or now in particular with LHC, we see a tremendous amount of resonance in the general public, with students, etc. I think the number of students is going up in physics because there are these beacons. You need from time to time a beacon which is extremely interesting in order to attract people. And then with these projects, you push the frontiers of technologies. And I have listed here some examples from CERN, all these ones from the machine, superconductivity, magnets, cryogenics, etc. Heavy equipment transport and installation. This experiment CMS can be opened on, how long does it take? A few hours, I think, to open it. And you move hundreds of tons very, very precisely. So this is something which you can learn. Solid state detectors, resistant to high intensity radiation, control systems, information, etc., project management and coordination. Project management and coordination of such big experiments is a huge challenge. But it seems that physicists can do that. But again, you get a lot of young people learning that, and they then can go to industry. And cooperation. It's obvious that international scientific cooperation is vital. CERN, I repeat again, is a European infrastructure, but globally used. But scientific international cooperation is vital for all countries, be it developed, emerging, or developing. Scientific research needs to benefit everybody. And I think all countries have to realize this. And it provides, again, I'm at my beloved topic, it provides successful models for peaceful collaboration, cooperation. And this is what I like also, as I said already at the beginning with this project, Sesame, which hopefully does the same. Science is a universal language, and if you speak science, you can work together. That's important. So what are the essential ingredients to drive innovation? I think you cannot just do it like this. You need a concrete project with ambitious goals and a deadline. If you don't have a deadline, well, I work only against deadlines. Absolutely. So, I think. Who is not working with deadlines? Okay, nobody admits that, okay. You need, of course, highly competent and motivated teams in all domains and at all levels. It's not only the physicists, it's the engineers, it's the technicians, it's everybody. And all are equally important. Very important is an open collaboration. Universities and research institutes. Industrial partners for key technologies. You cannot just develop magnets and then tell industry to build it. You have to involve industry from the beginning, otherwise you fail. You learn from others, but you share the results freely. And very important is investment in training and education. And training and education is key. And we just had a short talk in the rector's office, where we were especially concentrating or talking about education. You start at this age, and then you go through all the ages. You need to really fascinate and educate then people. And we have programs for kids in school. One of the programs is slip into the code of a physicist. These are 7 to 10 year old primary school kids. They have to write down how they imagine a physicist. It's fantastic what they imagine. But one thing I remember very well, one guy was writing that the physicists at CERN are keeping extraterrestrial people in the caves. Now once we have collected that, and they have delivered that, discussed it, they come to CERN and visit CERN, and afterwards they write it again. And then of course it's boring. Then they know how physicists are working. But this is it's a great program which spreads over in the neighborhood everywhere in at our place. And then of course we have a teachers program to have teachers there for 1 up to 3 weeks in order to get remotivated to talk about curricula in school and how to promote science and physics in school. And these people, these teachers have sparkling eyes when they leave again. I don't know for how long, but at least they get remotivated, and a good teacher is key. A good teacher is absolutely vital. And I must say here, Turkey could do a little bit more. Turkey had up to now in these years, only 74 teachers sent to CERN. And we have these teachers program in the language, in the mother tongue of the teachers, so they can use the material also in school directly. So I think here's something. I'm no longer responsible for CERN, so I can say, look, do a bit more, okay? You see that UK is very strong here. They also use foundations in order to promote the teachers program. And you can see how it started. It started very low, very small. And then when we started with the national language program, we have now between 1,000 and 1,200 teachers every year going through this program at CERN. And of course, these teachers produce hopefully more physics students. These are the summer students which visited CERN at CERN 2015. You can see it is from 2015 because it was a very dry year. This is normally a green field here. And you see here also that Turkey is doing very well with 7 young people coming last year to the summer student program. But again, that program is open to all the institutions in the world. Roughly 300 per year are going through that program. Another key issue is outreach. I mentioned already, all countries need scientists, engineers, etc. So we have to have targeted outreach activities. I already talked about these educational ones. We have now exhibitions to bring science closer to the general public, also to the politicians. We have one mock-up of mock-up of the LHC tunnel where you can play proton soccer. So you have virtually 2 protons which you can kick. And I played proton soccer with the Prime Minister of Greece. I played proton soccer with the Queen of Belgium. And she was playing it in high heels. And she was good. It was great. It is really fun for the kids and for the adults. And for the kids, you encourage interest in the careers in science. And I think one important point is that society needs to realize and appreciate science. I don't have my mobile here, but I think many people don't appreciate what is in a mobile. How much brain power is in a mobile? How much basic science first is in a mobile? And then applied science, of course. How much science in general is in a mobile? People don't appreciate that nowadays. And I like very much the editorial on the LHC in July 2012. They were talking about something like, for non-physicists, the importance of finding the Higgs belongs to the realm of understanding rather than utility. It adds to the sum of human knowledge. Then they quote that it is a 10 billion project. And then comes a very nice quote. That is still a relatively small amount to pay for knowing how things really work, and no form of science reaches deeper into reality than particle physics. And as this guy once put it, the universe may be not only queerer than we suppose, but queerer than we can suppose. Yet given the chance, particle physicists will give it a run for its money. I could not have written it better. It's very nice. So if you read such articles, then you know you have done good outreach, that it's appreciated. So we have to bring innovative science, exciting results, for example, achieved not only, of course, at research institutes, but also infrastructures, but also at universities, and their application to societal challenges to the notice of society. I think that's extremely important for everybody. We need more imaginative and ambitious outreach activities, and I think here, again, the different countries of CERN are already getting together, outreach activities are coordinated, and that's very, very important. But also scientific instrumentation is key. We have cutting-edge science, and that relies on cutting-edge instrumentation. We develop, together with universities, of course, new technologies and techniques. It's a significant market for high-tech industry. It has, of course, high initial cost and long timescales. Again, long timescales, you have to have stamina. So we have to strengthen the relations between the infrastructures and industry in the field of scientific instrumentation. That's not very easy there. We still have to do a lot. But we have to promote not only technology transfer. For me, it's much more important to promote knowledge transfer. It's knowledge and technology transfer. And the knowledge transfer is, of course, the knowledge is, of course, transferred through the visiting scientists. And that's the age distribution of the visiting scientists at CERN. And you see it peaks at 26. It peaks at 26 because these are the PhD students. And this was done more than 5 years ago. So I know that these guys are now 31. However, why do I say that? Because today we have many more PhD students than more than 5 years ago. So the peak would be much higher here because we have nearly 3,000 PhD students in the LHC experiments. Well, it reaches out to here, but it's okay. I share an office now with this guy. Okay. Funding agencies very often are saying, come on, what are you doing with so many PhD students? Yeah? So they cannot all stay in academia. Where do they go? Well, now you need good eyes. But the first employment after the PhD is to roughly 50% in the private sector. So we are, despite the fact that particle physics is sometimes considered as a sort of esoteric or whatever, far from application, however, it gives a fantastic education, a very broad education, very focused education concerning projects. Roughly 50% are going directly to the private sector, so we are educating, training, not only for academia, but also, of course, for the private sector. And then, in these 50%, roughly one-third of it goes to computing, and then also engineering, physics, etc. Of course, then later on, more and more go into the private sector. But I think it's astonishing, it's a very good signal that so many are going immediately to the private sector. But technology transfer also plays a key role here. And you see here are application fields, and here are technological domains at CERN. And if you now project this onto the back plane, you see medicine, diagnosis, material analysis, aerospace, accelerators, environment, etc. But medicine here again, is very strong. Medical applications are one of the strong fields of application from particle and nuclear physics. And this is the last example I want to give as an example of fantastic spin-off which combines physics, information technology, biology and medicine to fight cancer. The first thing is you have to locate the cancer, you have to have imaging, and that you do with PET scans, with a positron emission tomography. And the modern PET scans are using detector parts which were developed for the CMS experiment. The crystals and the electronics were developed for the CMS experiment and found very quickly their way into the medical application. Modern PET scanners are using these pieces. Now, when you have located the tumor, you can treat it instead of with X-rays with hadrons, that means either with protons or with light ions, light carbon ions, and you can treat because of the absorption curve, which is much more peaked and can be moved with energy, you can treat certain cancers much, much better than with X-rays, because the X-rays are also affecting the healthy tissue, whereas carbon ions and protons are much, much less effective here. And CERN is involved in quite a few of these hadron therapy centers. The latest one, which will be inaugurated, I think, this year, is in MedAustron, is in Wiener Neustadt, close to Wien in Austria. So, let me conclude with the last paragraph again of something which we have not written ourselves, but with the last paragraph of the editorial in The Guardian, which was written March 2015 on CERN LHC after just before the restart. So it was looking for what will come out. The search will invoke mini black holes, antimatter, quark, gluon plasma, extra dimensions of space, etc. The partnership so far has spun off colossal technological and computing rewards, but that is not the point. The point is that Europe is working together in a thrilling intellectual exploration that can have no conceivable commercial or political payoff, but could in some still intangible way enlighten all humankind. And I think the last sentence is absolutely important today. In these otherwise murderous and mean-spirited times, that is something to salute. I think this is a fantastic editorial, I must say. So, the role of large-scale scientific infrastructures is to innovate, to discover, to publish, and to share, and to bring the world together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We can now start a question and answer session. If you have any questions, we can get them.
Well, extremely stimulating talk and presentation, but I think it's missing one example. The oldest related example of Michael Faraday, when he invented or discovered, we should rather say, the electromagnetic induction, that is shaking a magnet and generating electric current. The Prime Minister asked him what it is good for.
I know.
And the answer is, I know not, sir, but I reckon that Your Excellency's government will soon find a way to tax it.
Yes, I know this example very well. I give it from time to time. I have more such examples. And here it was not so much only on basic science. I wanted to cover more all science and not pick out with such examples the fundamental research only. But I fully agree with him. Yeah, we don't know. That's a disruptive innovation. We don't know what comes out. It took 40 years for the PET scan to use positrons after the discovery of the positron in the hospital. It's a fantastic example.
You mentioned mentioned an interim upgrade on the LHC. Can you say a few more words on that? What kind of upgrade it will be?
When you have these packets of protons, where you have roughly 100 billion protons here and 100 billion protons here, and you collide them, nothing happens, okay? Because the protons will not find each other. So what you do, what we do today, you have to focus the proton. You have to squeeze these packets together a little bit so that they are in a more confined space. And in the way we are doing that today, we have several tens of protons hitting each other. The upgrade is to use much stronger magnets, for which we have to use different type of superconductor, in order to squeeze these packets even more. And then instead of a few 10, then we have around 100 to 200 protons hitting each other. That means you have per collision of packets, you have 100, 150 protons hitting each other. That means you have to disentangle very, very finely these different 100, 150 collision points. And for this, also the detectors have to upgrade. That means they have to replace all of their inner detectors, more granular, faster, longer memories, etc., and much more radiation resistant. After roughly 10 years, the present magnets and the present inner detectors of the inner parts of the apparati, they are radiation damaged and are no longer as useful as they are at the beginning. So this is a 10 years program now in order to develop and to build new inner detectors, mainly new inner detectors, and these magnets. And this is all in international collaboration again.
Thanks for this lecture. As a social scientist, I understood everything. I cannot repeat it again, perhaps some parts of it, but I understood that's something. So thanks very much for that. I have two questions. You made a premise saying that science needs competition as well as collaboration. I had a problem with the first part. Why need competition? Can you perhaps expand on that? Does really science need competition? Could it really only do with collaboration? Perhaps is the sort of larger structure of society that teaches us that. Maybe not. I'm just sort of putting that on the table. And the second thing is, you sort of put a brilliant sort of structure over there. And are there any social scientists involved in expanding this project, in sort of perhaps studying what you're doing, how you're collaborating? That would be an interesting part.
There are a few PhDs, I think, and master works which have been done in that direction from social scientists. Yes, but not very many. Maybe one could do more. Yeah. on the competition collaboration part, first of all, if you take human nature, maybe that's a smaller argument. If you take human nature, if you don't have competition, you don't progress because you still have time. You are not forced to be better than the other. I think that hinders progress, to my mind. Then I always tell the young people, never believe a result from one group only. It has to be verified by another group. We would not have announced the discovery of the Higgs boson if only Atlas would have told me in my office that they have close to 5 sigma significance. I needed CMS to give me the same. And this is not collaboration, this is competition. They wanted to be first, they wanted to be first, they were both at the same time. But you need this competition, this regulation. We have seen many, many results which were coming from fluctuations, from wishful thinking, from wrong measurements. And you need always a competitor which looks into the same thing and then tells you, yes, I see the same or I don't see the same. A very good example is this pentaquark story. One of the experiments at CERN. This is only one experiment now. Now I'm contradicting myself a little bit. I see that. But I don't think it's a contradiction. A real one. They have announced the discovery of pentaquarks. Pentaquark is nothing special, it's 5 quarks, just 4 quarks and 1 antiquark. And the standard model predicts for the mesons 2 quarks, for the hadrons 3 quarks. that's normal, but then there should also a five quark state should exist. And we had over the past 20, 30 years, always discoveries of pentaquarks. They were even confirmed from others. And that was some partially wishful thinking, I think. When you know where to look, you look differently than if you don't know where to look. And then they were all disproved. So no pentaquark discovery survived the competitors at the end. Why do I believe that now this new one survives? Because they did not only a kinematic reconstruction, but also a very sophisticated additional analysis, because they have the precision, they have the statistics, and comparison between the background and the peak, and that convinced also the management that this is real. I would like to see a competitor here to repeat that, but there's no competitor at the moment. We are too good. Okay, no, that was a joke. But Jan, just do you see my competition point?
Could you please expand? You there was. I know a couple years back, not sociologists, but there was a gathering of philosophers and theologians. That's a different thing, yeah. But
that's a different thing. This is one thing which I introduced at CERN also. This is to get scientists, philosophers, and theologians together to discuss. We had up to now 3 meetings. The first meeting was under the topic, can we find a common language? Now, this is important, because if a scientist talks about proof, he or she understands something completely different compared to a philosopher or a theologist. Yeah? You have first to define what you mean with a certain word. That's not easy. I don't think we are yet there. But that's different. So there we are discussing, are there similarities? Can we profit from each other? But that's different to the sociological effect.
One related question. This is somewhat personal. Now, you said you want competing experiments like ATLAS and CMS. Once you are part of the one experiment, you know what is going on in that. And the other experiment, your competitors are hiding their what they have found from you. How does it feel to be a person who actually hears everything for the kind of first time? I mean, you get to hear to talk both parties, and on the whole of the world, you are maybe one of the couple people or 3-4 people who knows what's going on.
It feels much better. Actually, sometimes I know it only after I have read it on Twitter or wherever. But the point is, in order not to bias one versus the other, you need to try to keep the results apart, because you can influence the other one too well. And if you read the press release for the Higgs boson, the only person who used the word discovery was me, because I knew where you were and I knew where you were. But you didn't know from each other how far you were, so you could not use the word discovery. So I had a privileged position. Okay, that feels good.
Maybe it's also possible to add to the example of the competition, not the competition within a facilities lab like CERN between experiments, but also Tevatron-ly giving a hand to LHC, how much they pushed harder towards the end for a tougher, let's say, search strategy towards Higgs, trying to be before maybe LHC being able to discover with their own potentials.
Very good example, because this is I'm stupid. It's the best example of collaboration and competition. Because Tevatron, that was the competing accelerator collider at Fermilab near Chicago in the US. They were trying, as you just said, to find the Higgs before us, before CERN. But when the LHC was broken, they sent people to help us to repair it, independent of the competition. And it was a very, very important help. They were crucial in fixing things. In addition, in the collaborative part, again in the collaborative part, many people at the LHC experiments were also at the beginning in the experiments at the Tevatron learning the high energy proton or proton-antiproton collisions. So there was a clear competition because, of course, the US wanted to be, Fermilab wanted to be first. It was not only the US because Europeans were in, but so Fermilab wanted to be first. But nonetheless, there was a fantastic collaboration, and I think that's the right spirit.
Another item I have, you mentioned about people telling you, now you found the Higgs, so you're all done, right? And you've just shown the, let's say, distribution of how much of the universe we seem to understand, the 5%, and where's the standard model, towards, I mean, within standard model, and also with the discovery of the latest Higgs particle. But it's maybe also good to mention, or let's admit, that even Higgs does not serve for the 5%, but maybe about a couple of orders of magnitude less than that, because we know that the sum of the masses of the protons don't make up the sum of the, let's say, so we're still...
The Higgs gives is a messenger of the mechanism in order to give, make it scientifically correct, which gives mass to the fundamental particles, has nothing to do with our mass and with the mass of the protons. This is the strong force, essentially. And that is studied also in the lead-lead collisions. Yeah.
And about the outreach, I also very much appreciate the effort put at CERN with this project called Beamline for Schools. And I think it happened for twice, at least as far as I know.
Yes,
and
because that's another thing which I introduced, yes.
Yeah, and that was during your time.
It was not my original idea. It was, if you give people, that's another message, by the way, if you give people freedom, they develop ideas. And then it's up to you to canalize these ideas, because if you have too many ideas, you don't reach anything. Beamline for Schools is a competition where school classes or groups of people in schools can submit a scientific project, and if they are the winners, they get 1 week beam time, real beam time at one of our accelerators. And the final choice of the winners is done by the same committees which select the scientific projects. So they are treated like young scientists. And we had two winners in the first year, two winners in the second year, and they collaborated immediately. And even the ones who did not win were stating to us, it's a fantastic experience, we learned to collaborate. So, it's a, and I met, of course, both times the winners. And they all told me, we don't want to leave. We want to stay. That's success.
Okay, there has been someone who has been waiting for almost 10 minutes now. So I'll get that and after that I'll...
Okay.
But okay, you have
where? Where do you see the Sesame project over the next few years?
Ask me when I am the president. Now CERN is strongly involved. We have just a few days ago, CERN has shipped the last remaining magnets to Jordan to finish the construction of the synchrotron. The commissioning should start in October, I think. That's the present planning. So I hope that the first light is somewhere in early next year. And then the main job will be to get the user community together to keep it there and to make the experiments. So I see my job then to get sustainable funding, to make this facility a high class, I'm not sure world class, a high class facility in the Near East, in the Middle East, with all the different cultural background people working together, making experiments at the beamlines. So this is a diplomatic challenge, but somebody has to take it.
Altu Uğurlu, mechanical engineer, 1980, Bosphorus University. Thank you, Professor Heuer. Very impressive presentation. I have worked at various levels in energy projects throughout my professional life. And would like to compare the project to two components, intellectual and brain power, and hardware second. During your tenure, how much do you think have you spent on hardware in for infrastructure with respect to what you purchased or what you built through third-party contributors, as opposed to the expenditures for all the staff, administration, and researchers? Thank you.
Well, you should not only, this is a long-term project, so you cannot only take out a slot of a few years, because it goes through cycles. You have a cycle where you construct such a machine. In such a cycle, you spend much more money on hardware, on bits to the industry than when you are running the project. So when I took over, we had to spend a little bit, not so much more, on the repair of the machine, and then we had a few years where we had more or less spent money on the exploitation, and then we increased again the amount of expenditure in the hardware in the preparation for the upgrade, because that's a 10 years project. So it goes through cycles, but it has but the budget is flat. So when you go through such cycles, since you have a flat personnel expenditure also, you need to accumulate a certain depth. You have to take some short-term loans, which you then, in the times of the stable running, you pay off. So you go through such cycles. Well, normally, we have around 60% in personnel expenditure. It's a huge infrastructure which you have to support. We have roughly 50 kilometers of accelerator. We have, I don't know how many hundreds of kilometers of cables and God knows what. And an old infrastructure which needs from time to time more maintenance.
Thank you for this interesting talk. And it's an excellent idea to bring children, teachers, philosophers, and theologians. But perhaps one should think of bringing together politicians who are running countries. Why not a small 3-day or 2-day seminar? I can give you names.
If you can you imagine to get for such a thing politicians for 2 or 3 days to CERN? We get politicians to CERN. We have high-level visits up to presidents, kings, prime ministers, etc. And they are all very, very impressed. The question is how long? Because they have a tremendous agenda. They visit many, many things. But if a minister or a president or whoever was at CERN and he or she has then to decide about some budget issues for CERN, they know, they remember, and they remember that they were fascinated, and then the signature gets on the paper a little bit faster.
Because they are the people who will guide their nations towards demanding better science and technology. Thank you.
Yes, I know, but that's a Sisyphus work, I can tell you. No. I went to Davos during my tenure every year, because we have to show face and we have to remind people about science, and in particular about basic science. But the biggest mistake you can make is to move Davos to CERN, because what you have to do is you have to keep politics outside the fence. CERN is CERN because the politics is outside the fence. This is very important. If politics gets into the fence, the whole spirit of CERN is gone, and that would be a disaster. So whatever you discuss concerning politics, not to impress politicians, for this you have to bring them in. But whatever you discuss on politics behind the scenes, you do outside the fence and behind the scene. So That's fun from time to time, I can tell you.
How about other research infrastructures of Europe? I've been following this S3 infrastructure, where there is the overall budget requirements is an order of magnitude lower, and there is the issue of prioritization, always problems with money flowing and people flowing. Are you optimistic that the CERN model can be utilized for the smaller scale infrastructures where the essentially some of the applications are imminent, so it's not the basic science in the front, but there are challenges which could help from competition if we can manage that thing going?
Yeah, but these are different questions in the same one part. I think the CERN model is independent of fundamental or applied research. I think that you can do. I think the CERN model is successful because it gives the management enough leverage and responsibility to do a project. If you take one of the big projects like ITER, this is not the case. And this was a mistake from the very beginning. And this is where it suffers. So I think ESO, ESA, they are very much modeled after CERN. So quite a few of the aspects of the CERN model are taken by some of the new infrastructures. The bigger problem is first to prioritize, because the very first S3 roadmap was just a wish list. It was just a list of every country needed to be in there at least once or twice, I don't know. Now they are reducing it a bit and making stronger cuts and stronger demands on progress of the infrastructure, etc. Still, I think the model has one flaw. And that is that there is money to build the facility, but it's ignored how much it costs to run and maintain the facility. So you produce new facilities, and then you are suddenly there in a country which doesn't have the money or the resources to run the facility. I think this is one of the big problems. I can't solve that, but I see the problems, and I think also the politicians see the problems, and this is why they try to restrict the S3 roadmap now more. But this is a different question with respect to the CERN model. But the CERN model has proven successful now over more than 60 years, because it also has a convention which allows to adapt to changing conditions. It is a European infrastructure, but it's formulated in such a way that you can also have members from outside Europe. You can interpret it differently. No convention today is written like this, I think. Everybody wants to pin down everything down to the last letter. And that removes all the flexibility in 10, 20 years. That's the problem. So there are many problems. But yeah.
But I know that you're also an avid soccer player, well, goalkeeper.
I was the Opel goalkeeper, and we were the worst, but we had the best spectators. We had the best crowd to support us, but we were, okay. I was goalkeeper because I like soccer, but I don't have any physical strength. I don't want to run, but I can take responsibility, and that's a goalkeeper. Okay. But you were not successful.
Sorry. Heuer, thank you for the speech. My question is a little bit personal, so do feel to not answer it. As a person not involved in science, I love science, but I also fear science. Science has brought us life-saving technology, but also it brought out the weapons of mass destruction. If by chance in your lifetime, if you were to experience the birth of a weapon, a terrifying weapon, born from the direct or the indirect application of the findings at CERN, would you feel any burden on your conscience?
Would that?
Would you feel any burden on your conscience?
Well, first of all, at the moment, I don't see anything which could come out of CERN which would not come out from anything else, because a priori our research is completely off the military application. What you are saying at the beginning, you can use essentially anything what you are doing, you can use for the good or for the bad. The same applies for medicine. Yeah? If you take medicine in the right dose, it's fine. If you take too much, it's bad. So you can use essentially all results in a positive or negative way, I think. What we do at CERN is at least to be as open as possible, as transparent as possible. We are not hiding any result. So whatever is coming out there is soon common knowledge. And I don't see that you can use anything what we find out here for weapons which you wouldn't have already beforehand. But if you produce radiation-hard silicon detectors, you can also use them in space for surveying other countries. But then you cannot do anything. It's not only restricted to research, you cannot do anything. If you play baseball, what can you do with this baseball? What is a baseball hitter? You can kill people. So should you stop playing baseball? Well, I have never played baseball. But you can use all examples. The main thing is that you yourself keep a clear eye on what you or your laboratory is doing, that it's always going in the right direction.
Thank you.
Zuerst möchte ich mich an Ihnen kurz bedanken. Ich werde jetzt auf Englisch weitersprechen. Can we say there are smaller particles than quarks? And do you think that we are going to be able to find them?
We cannot say there are smaller particles than quarks, but we can say there might be smaller particles than quarks. It is not excluded that quarks have a substructure. Now, my personal opinion, it doesn't count, so I should not. But as a DG, I never offered a personal opinion, but now I'm no longer DG, so maybe I can offer a personal opinion. We have already boiled down the thing to 12 quarks and leptons. To boil it further down, I think, is extremely difficult. I can't see that. But that's a personal opinion, but it's not excluded. So I think we have to look into it, because many years ago other people would have said no, there cannot be a substructure below the protons and neutrons. And if it exists, we can find it if we have higher power in our microscopes.
Is it universe infinite small? Can we say that?
What is infinite small?
So there will be always more smaller particles.
No, I told you, I don't know. I told you, I don't know. And I told you, if there are smaller particles than the quarks, then there have to. If it's more subparticles than we have at present as quarks, I would think the whole beauty would be destroyed. And I like the beauty in here. So, but I don't know.
Thank you.